Okay, hello everyone. So my name is Phil Jones. I'm course leader for graphic design, and I'll be happy to take you through this presentation that we usually do on our open days. So yeah, it takes about 40 to 50 minutes, I guess. So the first thing I'd say is people often think that graphic design is that you just do this one thing, but actually there are many different kinds of jobs you can get as a graphic designer. There's a few of them you can see on screen here. So we've had people going into all different kind of walks of life. So art direction, where it's well known through kind of advertising, design consultancies. Art editors are people that are kind of in control of the look and feel of something like a magazine or a book. But also there are kind of new sectors opening up all the time. So like, for example, service design is quite new, which kind of came about sort of 10, 15 years ago now. But you can design kind of services just as you can design products. And graphic designers are often involved in those kind of groups that kind of put service designs together. You can be a consultant, a tutor like me. You can be an entrepreneur. We've had people go into kind of fashion and do things. So there's a whole range of different kind of options available to you. In a similar kind of way, people often think that you come into a graphic design course and you sit down in front of a kind of computer and then you stay there for 3 years. We actually do quite a lot. Something usually goes through a computer at some point. But having said that, we use a whole range of different resources. So we don't expect you to have any knowledge of things like InDesign, Photoshop, Illustrator when you first come onto the course. We teach all of these things from sort of first principles. Nonetheless, by the time you land, you will have kind of engaged with these things. But as well as that, hopefully you'd have gone into lots of other sorts of things as well. So for example, we use people that have produced work with old chairs or skin or masking tape. And I'll show you some examples of that later on in the presentation. So this is from our Unistats website. So you can sort of see our, as the university, we have a great reputation in terms of employability. And you can sort of see there that there's a whole, there's no people unemployed, for example. What I always recommend people to do is to look at those eyes and let your cursor, if you visit the website, just sit over one of those eyes, because that gives you the stats on which these statistics is based, which will help you, I think, if you're comparing courses. It's quite a useful kind of resource. What really is important is where our students wind up going, because that's about the kind of quality of the job as well as actually just getting a job. And I'm happy to say some of our students go to some of the best kind of design companies in the world. All sorts of things. So if we have people like creative directors at Apple, local companies as well are really interesting, like Bright Blue Day. Some of our students have set up companies. So for example, Man vs. Machine was co-founded by one of our ex-students. So some great top companies there that hopefully some of you will recognise. So what kind of resources do we have on the course? So the key kind of thing, I guess, is human resources. And I'm really kind of proud of my course team. So, I'm the course leader, and we take on maybe 100, 110 sort of students every year, which is quite a lot. But actually what that does give us is a lot of kind of hours that we can use to employ lecturers. And the whole philosophy of the course, in a way, is about diversity. We try and produce a whole wide range of different kind of outcomes. And so having different lecturers with different kind of specialisms is a really kind of useful thing for us. So, for example, we have lecturers that have been creative directors at companies like Design Bridge. Some of our course team, like it's a chap called Malcolm Kennard, who's been course leader at Kingston for many years, really well known in kind of design education circles. Alice Stevens, who was... she worked a lot with Channel 4. She's done kind of TV things. Some of you might remember Eurotrash if you're of a certain age. She did the kind of title sequences for that. And we also have like three PhDs on the course at the moment. So we have a whole range of different people with different abilities. We also have visiting lecturers that come onto the course. So visiting lecturers are really important for us because they kind of keep us plugged into the real world. So I stopped kind of working in design and the outside world back in 2003. So staying current is a really big, important thing for a BA course to achieve. And visiting lecturers do that for us. They keep us informed about what's actually happening at the moment. We have a really interesting VT called Pali Palavathanan, who's got his own company in London called Templo, which is a really successful company in its own right. And he's kind enough to give us like a few days a year where he kind of comes in and does workshops with the students and so forth. So really useful thing. And then there are kind of technician demonstrators. So students usually love these because they help you to fabricate things. They demonstrate software for you. So there's a whole, lots of ways that they'll help you to achieve what you want to achieve. We're very outward facing as a course. So, we like lots of industry visitors come and do presentations with us. Some really famous people. So, for example, Michael Johnson's coming next week. Top people, well-known, respected designers, world-famous people that come and talk on the course, which is great. Our alumni as well, they often give back to the course, so they'll come and explain what it's like to move from the world of being a student into the world of being a designer, which is really useful as well for our students. In terms of physical resources, we have base rooms for each year. So we don't sort of tend to teach the whole 100 students in one kind of lump, unless it's something like a lecture. So after that, they're broken into like half groups or quarter groups, and that's how we kind of deal with things. So you're usually in the first year, you're probably in 4 days a week, maybe not all day, you might just be in for a morning or an afternoon, but there's a kind of engagement there that goes right the way through. We have computer suites, we have two of those, we share those with VizCon, which is great. A makerspace too that we share with VizCon. We have extra tutorial spaces, there's a little kind of photographic area for doing pack shots, things like that. And then there are kind of college-wide facilities, things like the bindery, the workshop, and the print room. So to use those, you have to be inducted. So kind of obviously health and safety things involved with that, which we kind of do. But after that, then it's negotiable and you're able to kind of use those things as you need them for your projects. So this is Pally doing a talk to our third years in the third year studio. And that's the makerspace that we share. So this is the kind of course in a nutshell. There are three levels, level four, level five, and level six. Level four is the first year, level five the second, level six is the third year. And you'll see each of these kind of grey rectangles, which are units of study. So there are three units in the first year. Within each unit, there might be sort of several briefs, and then you get assessed at the end of each unit. So the first one is exploring graphic communication, which introduces you to typography, and also the kind of ways of ideating, getting ideas going, a kind of visual language that you'll start to develop. Visual thinking is about how we use visual things to think about the world. And then graphic design studies is where we actually start stepping out into the real world and doing projects with other people. So last year, for example, the students did a project with the Design Museum where they went up to the Design Museum, they were briefed. They worked in groups, and then the top 10 were sent off to the Design Museum. They chose three of those groups, and they actually presented in the Design Museum to some of the top marketing people there. So really interesting project. In the second year, we have these different headspaces that we put students through. The first one is visual systems, which is all about the kind of systems that we have in graphic design. So whether they're kind of color systems, type systems, content management systems, if you're designing a website, there's this thing called kind of generative graphics, which is really that you concentrate on a process and that process kind of delivers something. If it's not quite what you want, you don't kind of tinker with the outcome. You go back to the process and re-engage with that to make that so it does start producing these outcomes that you're trying to seeking. After that, there's a unit called text sequence and interaction, which is about sort of storytelling, really. There's in that you'll kind of design websites. There might be some motion graphics that you'll do. And then there's two smaller units. One's called Innovate and one's called Defining and Refining Themes and Issues. So Innovate is an engagement with the kind of user-centered agenda. So there's a kind of big move in graphic design over the last 10, 15, 20 years or so to move away from star designers having big ideas to actually working more collaboratively with our users to understand what their needs are. And so that's quite a good project, and it's quite ethics-based as well. So it's about kind of doing good. And then alongside that is defining and refining themes and issues, which is about really focusing on an outcome that you're going to take up in your third year in your investigative study, which is a kind of a piece of writing about 5,000 words that students do on a topic of their choice. Also in level six, there's specialist practice, which is full of kind of competition briefs and also sometimes live projects as well. So we do kind of usually we engage with Design and Art Direction, DNAD, the Royal Society of the Arts, RSA, and also International Society of Typographic Designers. And they produce like many briefs that you're able to choose from. And, you know, you can enter work as well, usually around about sort of March time. And we do really well in those competitions. I'll show you some examples of that later on. And then there's the major project. So there aren't kind of too many times in your career where you can write a project for yourself and then take a long time to kind of explore them in depth. And the major project is really useful for that. So yeah, that's the kind of course in a nutshell. So the interview then. So our interviews are kind of really friendly. They last maybe 10-15 minutes. It's not about giving you kind of a tutorial or about doing feedback. What we're really trying to do is just understand your story. There's not necessarily a checklist of things either that we're looking for. It's more that I'm really interested in knowing what your kind of options were, what opportunities you've been given, and how you kind of grabbed those and made something of them. So the work I'm going to show you is obviously a collection of lots of different students' work. So very few people are this good. I think I'd be struggling to show work consistently as good as this across the piece. Students bring certain things to interviews. Sketchbooks are one of those. So for me, kind of sketchbooks are unedited things. So you get spreads like this look amazing. The next spread though might not be half so good. And as far as I'm concerned, that's fine because the sketchbook necessarily isn't a thing in itself. It's more taking you somewhere. So that's how we look at sketchbooks. There's life drawing on the course. We really kind of respect drawing. So it's great to see kind of work. We don't do too much drawing, maybe lost a couple of sessions in the first year, but it's a really interesting kind of part of being a graphic designer, I think. And so some designers can draw really well like this, others though really can't draw that much at all. And both of those are fine because like nobody's good at everything, as I say, so people have strengths and weaknesses. We like typography. I think these pieces were done on our foundations course here where students came over from there. Some nice laser cut typography. Innovative typefaces. This is quite old now, so it's maybe not as innovative as it once was, but you know, here's some sort of letters in the landscape. It's really nice using Google Earth to find these kind of letter shapes, which are a nice kind of touch. It's about finished work. What is finished? Sometimes finished things can be kind of very kind of raw and sometimes they can be very slick. We like both of those. What you will have to do as a graphic designer is bring lots of disparate things together. So usually it's like text, image, color, all sorts of things, making them fuse together so they feel like they naturally belong that way. It's a very difficult thing to do and lots of graphic design involves that as a kind of skill. We like students to look around themselves, that it's not just about being in your own headspace, that you actually go out and you kind of find things and bring them back. So you might have a collection or, you know, you might record things. At interview, like, it's great to see digital video, but sometimes we have like problems with it won't work or something. So we actually really like storyboards. Storyboards are a great way of saying something really quickly and seeing if it's kind of working or not. So this storyboard is obviously about like laces coming alive and doing something kind of crazy. So really good and very quick to kind of look at. So we, you know, it takes all the stress out of a kind of interview as well. You're not worrying if it's something's going to run. It's just there to watch. It's not all about your work. So we like people that read, you know, and it might be that you're reading kind of Wittgenstein at the moment, which is great if you are. But equally, it could just be a kind of graphic novel, and that's fine too. Really genuinely interested in what it is that you're reading. So we would like people that look about them outside in the world. I've kind of talked about that. You've got to be motivated. You know, we want you to get through 3 years of study. So showing that you're motivated in an interview is really important. We want people that have an awareness of contemporary graphic design. So most interviews, I guess, you're going to be asked the question, who's your favourite designer? So we tend to get sort of similar sorts of answers, like Stefan Sagmeister or Neville Brody. So if they are, and that's great if they are your favourite designer, I think they're probably one of mine as well, then tell us why. What is it? Give us an insight why you think they're so good, because then it makes your kind of response more memorable for us, and, you know, it kind of shows you as being a somebody, an individual, not just one of those other people that like the same kind of graphic designers. We like you to have good communication skills. Obviously, that's important. You'll be pitching work by the time you leave the course. So, you know, being able to stand up and say, you know, why something's good or bad, that's great. Problem solving, obviously, to do with graphic design. And there's also different kinds of writing on the course, some academic writing to more like some things like kind of writing copy for designs or adverts. So this is our show that happens every year in the university. This is from a couple of years back now, but you can sort of see. Right, okay, so this is now some student work. So up until now, really, I haven't been able to kind of brag about anything because most of that work was done somewhere else. But now I can sort of gloat over how good this work is, okay? So I hope I don't make you feel too nauseous. So this is a major project. This is from a guy called Chris Burns. So his project was about dementia, obviously a major issue now with an aging population. And what we always say is, like, you know, you can't just launch into a project like that. You have to do some kind of research in order to get an insight. So the insight is the big thing. Sometimes insights can be quite banal in a way. They can be very simple and straightforward. And his insight was that something like that older people often have a favourite chair that they sit in. So my granny, for example, had a favourite chair, and if I sat in it when I was a little boy, a long time ago, I was kind of in trouble a little bit. So that's one thing, where a chair stands for a person. Another thing, though, is the idea of being above and below ground. So above ground is a kind of space that we can interact with, we can see things above ground, we can engage with them. The subterranean world, though, the world beneath our feet, we don't have access to. So it's a bit like your conscious and unconscious mind. So now we have these chairs that stand for people sort of slipping into this unconscious world. It feels a bit like kind of quicksand or something. So it's a very uneasy feeling. So you might say, okay, you know, I'd never get that if I was like walking along and I suddenly came across all these kind of chairs. But the idea of is that it just catches your attention. So we always say that you need kind of two things in graphic design. One is impact. You've got to grab somebody's attention to begin with. But once you have their attention, you also need relevance. It has to be relevant to something. And if you have both of those things, then you've got the making of a good piece of graphic design. So the relevance in this case, I hope you can just see those kind of plaques in front of each of the chairs. So that took you to a website where there were interviews with family members of people that had dementia. So there's the kind of relevance. And, you know, if you saw that, you know, the idea was that if you come off a, you know, train at Waterloo or something, these would be scattered around the concourse. And, you know, if I saw that at Waterloo, I'd go home and tell my wife about it when I got back, you know, with something that could spread interestingly. So that's that. This is a very different project. So the idea of this was designing out something. So, you know, there's this plastic thing that goes around the tops of packs of beer. And the idea was, okay, all that does is hold the beer together, and, you know, people dispose of it irresponsibly. And we've all seen the kind of David Attenborough things with fish being caught up in these kind of bits of plastic. So, you know, his idea was, okay, we'll make these kind of studs that are part of the process of actually making the can, pressing it, so the cans would snap together. But that's, in a way, not the real reason I'm showing you this. The real reason is that all of that was produced in Cinema 4D, except the hand which was photographed. So on the one hand, we like very kind of digital, like high-tech things. On the other, there's a guy buying old chairs from Oxfam and sawing the legs off. We like both of those and everything in between, okay? That we like the course to be that broad. So this is a first-year project, and it's one of my favourites, actually. It's a really nice kind of project about identity. So there's this resource that we use as graphic designers called the Pantone system. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that, but it's like these coloured squares that you get, and you can choose an ink that you're going to print with. So her nickname is Plume. So she called this thing Plume Tone. And what she did was she recorded lots of different bits of information that she had over social networking. So lots of small little fragments of things that she said, and then she graded them as to whether they were true or false. So white is true, black is false. And then what she did, collected kind of lots and lots of these that you can kind of see there. And what it actually makes is a picture of herself. So she is the kind of sum total of these kind of truths and lies that she tells, which is a really nice kind of identity project. This is an example of what we call a kind of provocation project. So it's about surveillance. So the idea was that, again, his insight was quite simple, that CCTV cameras tend to be positioned quite high up. So they're always often looking down on us. So his idea was quite simple, that you take an umbrella, you print the pavement on it. Now you've got this kind of middle class cloaking device. So so that works quite well. The one on the right he did in Photoshop, but we sort of said, no, that's not good enough. You've got to, you know, make a real umbrella. And then we felt a little guilty when we found out that that's quite hard to do. You've got to match up all the patterns and everything. But luckily, one of the strengths of this university is that we have these different courses dotted around the campus. And in this case, fashion were able to help him so that he could get match up the patterns, take it across a 3D surface. And he produced a range of umbrellas off the back of it. So this one is a form of camouflage known as dazzle, which, if I understand it correctly, was painted on kind of battleships in the First World War. And the idea is that a U-boat commander would sort of see the battleship on the horizon, but he would be more difficult to see which is the front and which is the back, so he wouldn't know where to kind of shoot his torpedoes. He actually produced a whole range of these, not just the dazzle, but several different kind of styles of camouflage as well. So another provocation project. This one is really get us thinking about donating organs after we die. So the idea was, okay, how do we, you know, there's a kind of ickiness about the body that we don't really like, you know, it's like, and it puts people off of thinking about donating things. So her idea was, okay, let's make a handbag out of human skin, which unfortunately we weren't allowed to do. So what we did instead was we found some latex. And again, we were helped by the makeup course here, which again, a really useful course. They do things like prosthetics and stuff, which is really exciting. And they were able to help our student to kind of fabricate these things, which was great. Okay, so we've got video on the in the presentation. We do a whole range of things like to do with motion graphics and a narrative that you know we'll see. Also like things like animated pictures. So this is a project I try and use to show how you get a job. So you might sort of say, Phil, okay, there's this weird work with umbrellas and broken chairs and whatnot. How the hell does that get me a job in graphic design? So this is another interesting project. The idea of this was it's about domestic violence. So stereotypically victims of domestic violence use kind of long sleeve shirts and things to hide the marks on their body. So Grace's idea was, okay, let's embroider these cuts and bruises on the outside of a shirt as a way of kind of showing solidarity with these people. So great idea, and you wind up with these kind of three shirts. But as I say, you might think, well, okay, that's great, but how's it going to get me a job? So I always say that you need two things to get a job. On the one hand, you need the kind of entry-level skills that all of us graphic designers use. So typesetting, you know, choosing the right paper, some level of photography, you know, book binding, a whole range of things. And this is a process book that Grace produced that showed the kind of process that she was working through to achieve those shirts. And she did all of those things in this book. So she's bound herself, she chose the paper, she took the photographs, and obviously she did all the typography. Grace got a great job at the end of it all, and she also had some really good work experience off the back of those shirts, so good stuff. So what are the drivers for graphic design? So there are kind of two examples here. The top row of buses is about kind of social design. So, you know, you can design for people. So these are about the aging population again. And it's really that these buses would go to a care home and visit people there. And they're kind of packed full of resources that would help older people to remember their youth. But technology can also be another great driver for graphic designs. And this student wanted to produce a whole set of uppercase characters using laser beams. So we filled in the health and safety forms. We kind of got the laser beams and the mirrors, and the mirrors rotate and you can make a whole set of uppercase characters from them. We do little bits of illustration as well on the course. So these are really interesting kind of photorealistic illustrations. But what really interests me about them is the way they're produced, because each one of these illustrations is produced by harvesting tiny little bits of other people off Flickr and then layering them up in kind of Photoshop. So they, you know, very kind of strange. And he made some videos showing the actual process, which was like amazing. We've engaged with World Skills, which not that many people have heard of when I kind of come to do these open day talks. So what World Skills is that every few years, it's a bit like the Olympics meets Bake Off, if I could put it that way. It starts with like they're focused around a whole set of skills. So there are things like, I think there is one for baking, for engineering things. There's a category for graphic design. And we haven't entered lately. We've just let that slip by us. But for two kind of iterations of World Skills, the country was represented from students off our course. So this is a guy called Harry Smith who got silver back in 2009. Okay, so award winners, people that remember I'm talking about a unit called Specialist Practice where students engage with competition briefs. So here are some of those students that have won awards. So this one is about a corporate identity for Croydon. So she did some primary research. She was from Croydon and she went out and found out and recorded how people spoke. And then the project was also sponsored by Pantone Colours. So she also found out what people's favourite colours were. She started recording the way people spoke phonetically. And then in each word, she kind of highlighted the phonetic spellings using a colour. And then that, as a kind of idea, was applied to Croydon Council as a kind of branding exercise. So really kind of, it's kind of like saying there's more than one way to be. You can be all these different things. So DNAD New Blood, this happens every year around Shoreditch, usually a kind of July, early July, late June kind of time. And there is a kind of competition they do every year, which is the Best Stand. So we got Best Stand in 2012, 2014, 2016, and several times in the noughties as well. ISTD, which is the International Society of Typographic Designers. So this project was about milestones in cancer treatment. So the idea was that you start off and it's looking at very kind of early interventions like surgery, but by the time you work through the book, you get to other things like immunology. And there was an aperture that was cut right through the book. So it's kind of a little bit like a cancerous tumour that's getting smaller as you kind of work through the book. This is again a pitch from two excellent students who both had internships at Pentagram and then with us back in 2017.
We are entering a world of business that is fundamentally changing. We are a globally curious generation, prone to seek out collaborative and flexible travel experience. Crowne Plaza needs to challenge the corporate conventions of hotels in order to speak to the new generation of young, modern business traveller. Crowne Plaza have over 400 hotels worldwide, and that number is growing. It's actually not doing too bad at all. So, what if instead of relaunching the whole business, we create an experimental offshoot? Introducing Net by Crowne Plaza, a flexible space for collaboration and connectivity. The name and brand identity? Well, it's based on the net of a cube, in which the different faces fit together to build strong relationships for networking. Net is the experiment of Crowne Plaza. Pop-up hotels, workspaces and events, moving with the face of business. Hotel spaces and events will become the center stage for the future of business and challenge the corporate conventions. Net is research through branding. So, imagine if we could bring this all back to the Crowne Plaza brand. Through a series of experimental spaces and events, could Net inform the future of business travel for Crowne Plaza?
Chris Newell, who has since been a kind of visiting lecturer with us, great guy. He set up his own business after leaving. He got a yellow pencil for this project back in 2012. So, and this, the idea comes, the reason I really like this one is it's kind of driven by theory in a way. So there's this idea that comes from film theory called diegesis, which is the idea of a kind of narrative world. So if I was a character in a narrative world, there would be some things I'd be aware of and things that I wouldn't be aware of. And usually, like the channel ident sits in the corner of the frame and it's non-diegetic, it sits outside of the narrative world completely. So his idea was that these would kind of flicker on once the film had started. And you can sort of see there's a reflection there in the lake. So he had lots of different ways of making that light spill onto things so that you felt like it was part of the movie itself, not outside of it, if you like. Alex Cosmidis got a merit for ISTD. So his idea was it's a kind of celebration of the work of Adrian Frutiger, a really famous type designer. If you've seen Universe, you've probably seen a very distinctive grid that kind of structures all of the different weights and stuff that to do with kind of the typeface. And this folds out to make that grid. It's a lovely piece of cardboard engineering. Okay, and this is another piece of video, so do check it out. This is a piece of animation, which is really interesting, which got a win at one Royal Society of the Arts last year for moving pictures.
Facts aren't enough. Post-truth will not tumble under the bombardment of more and more and more data. We now have a duty as supporters of liberal democracy to communicate facts in a way that recognises emotional as well as rational imperatives, and that this is a very, very difficult task. Politicians, for example, really do need to align factual claims with emotional significance. You know, obviously, they shouldn't sacrifice veracity to theatricality. That would be a disaster. But politicians of the future need to recognise the adulthood of the voters and not infantilise them with a kind of machine gun spray of data. It's very, very important that you come out and you stretch out a hand to the person making the objection, but in taking the hand, you speak to them as if they were grown-ups and not just saying, don't worry your pretty little head about it. There is a debasement of political discourse, which I think is really alarming.
Okay, so Pete Smart, again, great student. He, for his major project, he wanted to take time out and go around Europe and every day set himself a design problem and every day solve it. And fantastic guy. He went off He had a blog as well, which was like ridiculously successful. I think it was something like the 18th most designed website in the world, the most visited design website in the world at one point. He was getting all these kind of Sites of the Day awards. He did some little talks at places like Frog in Munich. When he came back, he worked in Bournemouth for a while. We've got quite a burgeoning kind of area in like digital in Bournemouth at the moment, which is quite exciting. But now he's head of UX design, I believe, at Fantasy in San Francisco. So he's moved like in a meteoric way right through to a great job at the end of it. Again, we do little bits of advertising on the course. So this is a YCN project, which is about Swarovski crystals, which is about how they don't let you down, unlike some other kind of fashion accessories. Okay, so this is just last year. These are the awards that we won last year. So you can see DNAD, they award kind of pencils. There are various different grades. We've got several sort of wood pencils. We also got somebody on DNAD Academy last year, which is really hard to do. We had ISDD accreditation, Royal Society of the Arts. Should be another kind of image there. Yeah, there's probably about three times that in terms of the awards. There's three of those slides that you should be able to see. And then finally, like the last section is about our alumni. What have our students gone on to do once they've kind of left the course? So this is Sarah Wickens. There's a part of Google called Google Creative Lab. And there's every year, Google Creative Lab takes on 5 interns from around the world. So it's like really hard to get onto. And some of the top people at Google Creative Lab have kind of gone through that pathway. So it's a really kind of useful exercise. And really proud of Sarah, who got onto that last year. And every year as well, the last 2 years, we've had a workshop at Google Creative Lab, which has been great, where all of the third years have gone up there to do a kind of workshop. Shazia was art editor of Icon magazine for many years. I think she went on to The Independent on Sunday, and now she's freelancing, I believe. Jason Ching, formerly an associate at Pentagram, he's now creative director at Turner Duckworth. So Pentagram, Turner Duckworth, major players on the kind of world scene, great design companies. Rosie, so this was a fantastic project. So basically the idea of this was that rather than doing a survey, she kind of handed out these cubes and asked people to imagine what their, you know, most dreamt of thing was that would be inside that cube. And people had like really creative kind of out answers that you would never have got from a survey. And I think it was so successful that they used it as actually part of their branding campaign, which is great. Toby Tinsley did the first round of branding for Virgin, the space probe thing. And then finally, Tim Swift, who co-founded Man vs. Machine, which again, have done sort of several things for Channel 4, Honda, Nike. They did a great project for Nike last year. Some beautiful work, world renowned, really good guy. So that's about it. So thank you very much. I guess if anybody's got any questions, more than happy to answer those.